having to do things to discipline his people sometimes. Now, here's verse 7. Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets. That word secret there could also have been interpreted as mystery. There's a mystery in God that he wants us to search out, to have a relationship with him. The Bible says what's the word that's used there in that verse? It's the honor of God to conceal a matter, but the honor of kings to search him out.
Yeah.
You got to have a relationship with God.
Right.
Amen? Amen? The Holy Spirit, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, it says that the Holy Spirit, Paul was describing how he worked with the Holy Spirit to do the things that he did, know the things that he knew about God. And it says that the Spirit searches on our behalf. The Spirit of God searches all the things of God, even the deep things of God. And that word deep means profound mysteries.
Yes.
So the Holy Spirit, on our behalf, searches out the profound mysteries of God about everything.
Yeah.
And as we learn to walk with the Holy Spirit, listen to the Holy Spirit, let him become our teacher, then he begins to teach us these secret things.
Thank you, Lord.
He that dwelleth, over at Psalm 91, it says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the covering or the overshadowing of the Almighty.
Yeah.
Well, you're going to abide in the secret place when you have this walking and talking relationship with God, and you let him bring you into that place of submission, obedience, and his plan, his purpose for your life.
Amen.
Amen?
Yes.
And it's a secret place.
Amen.
Surely the Lord will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets. Why is that true? Because God instituted the prophetic ministry, both then under the Old Testament and now today, to bring forth revelation to people so that they could take hold of that and walk in it.
Yeah.
There's many different causes and reasons that prophets do that. You know, the prophetic, I'm called to the prophetic ministry, and sometimes it's such a conflict within me at times, because when you have that calling on your life, it's like you live about half of your life in the future. I don't know how else to explain it.
Yeah.
Except to say that my thoughts are out there.
Yes.
Many times.
Yes.
And it doesn't mean I'm some super duper spiritual whatever. We're all prophetic. If you study the New Testament, there's a prophetic mantle or an ability. We all have the Holy Spirit in us. And he tells us that we can all prophesy one by one. You know, he's opened the door for us to have words of knowledge, words of wisdom, operate in the prophetic gifts of God and so forth.
Yes.
But God, especially under the Old Covenant here, he was explaining that God reveals these things that are going to come, good or bad. He reveals them through the prophets. Why? Because the prophet has to prophesy it out into this realm in order for it to be done.
Yeah.
Because when the prophet speaks on behalf of the Lord, it's really not the prophet speaking, it's the Lord speaking through the prophet.
Yeah.
God the King has made a prophetic decree from his throne in heaven. The prophet receives that decree, releases it out of his mouth. And just like on the day of Pentecost, it says that they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak. They did the speaking as the Spirit, God the Spirit, gave them utterance.
Yeah.
Right.
So there's this flowing together of God from heaven and from his throne through people prophetically. But the thing that happens is those words are released out into the earth.
Amen. Yes.
And the Bible teaches us that if, you know, over in the situation with Jehoshaphat and the people there, when they were going up against these three nations, they were outmanned, outgunned, outnumbered. He said, if you believe the prophet, you'll prosper.
Right. Right.
Prosper what? You'll flourish in what the prophet says.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
And we can get into that and dig around in that, but I want you just to see this today, that because of the next verse, verse 8. The lion has roared. He from verse 3 on, he made the case for cause and effect. The Bible says the curse causeless shall not come. There's a reason. Amen? The lion has roared, who will not fear? The Lord God has spoken, who can prophesy? Now notice he's equating the prophetic anointing to a lion roaring. If you study the four Gospels, you see that the Matthew's Gospel is the lion gospel. It's the king lion. It's the theme of that gospel. If you look for Jesus as being the Messiah, the King Messiah, And the lion of the tribe of Judah, Revelation says, and speaking of Jesus, the lion of the tribe of Judah hath prevailed over his enemies.
Right.
So it's that lion, it's that kingly position, it's that ability to rule, to dominate, to get victory, and so forth. That prophetic voice. The Bible has many scriptures that talk about God roaring out of Zion. You know, and there's just a lot of different things that have to do with that prophetic thing. And that's why the devil tried to, at least in the Western church, remove out of the church the idea that there are prophets.
Right.
And see, if you don't think there's prophets, then you won't cooperate with that ministry gift and you won't benefit from it.
Right.
Amen?
That's right.
So he's equating here the prophetic mantle with a lion. And in Matthew Gospel, you see that lion. In Mark's Gospel, you see Jesus being the servant. You see him being the ox or the bullock that, you know, that bears the burdens of people. You see that servanthood part of him. And then in Luke's Gospel, you see the human side of him. It portrays him as a God-man in Luke.
Right.
And then in John is the prophetic mantle, another side of the prophetic mantle, the eagle. The eagle, the one who soars with God in high places and looks at the earth from God's perspective and moves in with the Lord. But this prophetic mantle, this lion mantle, was upon the prophet here. He was explaining it to them, and God uses that mantle prophetically to rule and to dominate.
Yes.
And he wants to use you in it.
Yes.
I'm not saying you're a prophet. You know, the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher, that fivefold ministry that's talked about in Ephesians. I'm not saying you're necessarily called in one of those offices. If you are, you are. If you are, you'll know it. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Yeah.
And all that, but there's that prophetic element of your life to where you can stand up and by the Holy Spirit release words in prayer, in praise, in prophecy, even decrees. Because it teaches us, and we've looked at this in recent past as well, over in Revelation, John said that Jesus has made us kings and priests unto our God.
Yes.
We have that ministry upward toward God as a priest, like we just prayed over the offering toward the Lord. We ministered it to him on behalf of the people of this earth and so forth. But then there's that position, the Bible says, over in Ephesians, that we've been seated together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The only person that's seated is a king. A king is seated to rule. A king is seated to make judgment calls. A king is seated to decree, to roar as a lion from heaven and cause things to be brought into line. Defeat the enemies, scare the enemies, or whatever he has to do. And so we have those two things in us. As a born-again believer, there's the priestly ministry to God, but then there's the authority ministry from being seated in Christ Jesus as he rules over the earth. Praise God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen. So we see the lion's ministry here, the prophet's ministry here in Amos chapter 3. Praise God. There's Hosea, we won't turn there, but Hosea 11:10 says, "The Lord shall roar like a lion."
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Come on. Amen.
Praise God. You know, lions don't roar when they're hunting. Lions roar, they don't, you know, they're quiet, they're sneaking up on their prey. But lions roar, a lot of times they'll wait and they roar at night. And mainly for two reasons, from what I understand in studying this, is to warn other lions, this is my territory. They protect their territory. They try to put fear in other lions. You better stay away from this area, this is mine.
Right.
Amen? And they also roar to communicate to the lions of their pride to come to them. So it's that domineering thing of, you know, drawing lines and boundaries and territory, using fear. Amen?
Yeah.
And then also that thing of you know, letting the other lions that are in that pride, you need to come here, you need to be here with us. Right. So it's kind of a kingly, dominating control theme.
Yeah.
Mantle that goes on.
Yes.
With that in mind, let's turn over to 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5. in chapter 5, Peter is talking to the elders and to those that are under the elders, spiritually, so to speak. He speaks to the elders in verse 1. Down in verse 5, he speaks to the younger. Talks to them about submitting themselves to the elders and so forth. And the elders make sure they're doing what they're doing for the right reason, doing it the right way. Yeah. Amen. But look here at verse 5. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another. Notice he didn't just tell the younger to be submitted to the elders. He said everybody needs to submit to one another.
Amen.
I need to submit to the Jesus that's in you.
Yes.
That doesn't mean I let you pastor the church if God's told me to pastor the church. But at the same time, there's Jesus is in you in a way he's not in me.
Right.
In some ways, he's the same in you as he is in me. We're both born again children of God and brothers and sisters in the Lord and all that. But there are gifts and anointings and mantles and abilities that are in you that are not in me. Because you're a different part of the body than I am. So we submit to that. Amen?
Amen.
We honor the office.
Yes.
Humble yourselves, verse 6, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all of your care upon him, for he's got it covered. He cares for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But now, verse 8, this is what I want to get to. Be sober, be serious, be vigilant, means be on guard. Why? Because your adversary, your opponent, who is it? The devil.
Right.
As, everybody say as. A roaring lion walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Remember in the book of Job, when the devil came before God's throne, he asked him, where have you been? He said, I've been going to and fro in the earth.
Yeah.
So it says right here that he as a roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he may devour. Now notice, Peter here, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, tells us that the enemy tries to occupy the office of prophet.
Right.
He's a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Now that right there tells you that he can't just walk up and devour anybody he wants to anytime.
Right.
Amen.
But he's doing what a lion does. Remember we talked about the lion roars to warn, use the fear of his roar to warn people. Have you ever been around a lion? I was at the zoo one time when they did one of those, it's like a real deep, almost like a huffing zone. Have you ever heard that? Boy, there is no sound like that in all the earth. I was way on the other side of the zoo from where the lion was years ago. And then the lion started running, I thought, my God, what is that? And then I realized it was the lion over there. I think they said that a lion's roar can be heard, in most cases when it's quiet, up to like 7 kilometers away or something. I mean, it felt like that was almost shaking the ground when I listened to that. But he's as a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. He's our adversary. So what I want you to see here is I want you to see, because this is true of the devil in every area of the kingdom of God, he is always mimicking or counterfeiting everything God is.
Right.
And so he tries to counterfeit the prophetic ministry of God as well.
Right.
And he tries to be that dominant. He wants to appear. He wants you to, in your mind, to think that his prophetic, false prophetic roar is what you're to submit to and listen to.
Yeah.
Right.
You may start moving away from him and boldly walking out with the Lord, and he's going to roar at you in some way to try to pull you back in, intimidate you back to where he has you or had you before.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
Or if you encroach on his kingdom, you know, somehow, and you're getting people out of his kingdom, he's going to somehow roar prophetically against your life to try to back you off.
Yeah. Good word.
Yeah.
Now, his roar is not going to always be some, rawr, you know, it's going to be a voice that can come to your mind. It's going to come to, Jesus warned us, he said, in the last days there'll be many false prophets.
Right.
Amen. But the spirit of fear is the main way the devil rules those that have submitted to him. It's that element of being big, bad, and ugly.
Right.
I have the dominion. I'm the king. I'm in charge here. And it's that the spirit of fear comes in it to try to get us to shrink down into submission or to put ourselves in a position where he can devour our life with his lies. You see, the devil only has one weapon he can use against you, and that is deception. He has no other weapons. He has no power. He has no authority. He's got angelic power, fallen angelic power. He's a fallen angel. But he cannot, with that angelic power, he can't step over the line of encroaching in the kingdom of God and the blood of Jesus in your life unless you invite him in.
Yes.
Right.
And that's what the roar is about. Yeah. He's trying to get you to submit to the spirit of fear, intimidate you in some way, so that you begin to get an agreement and harmony with him, and you begin to somehow submit to him so he can come in and start working on building the deception into a place to where he can steal your health, steal your mind, just make your life miserable in general, keep you out of the ministry God's called you to. All of those things, and even more. But I want you to see that there's two roaring lions here. One's the real deal. Hallelujah. The other one's a false prophetic lie. Now, how do we tell the difference between that false roar and the real roar? Well, the Word of God, number one, is first and foremost the way you can tell. See, people that don't develop a relationship with Jesus are easily victimized by this roaring lion.
Yeah.
I know that because I've been there, done that.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah.
How can you tell whether the Holy Spirit's giving you thoughts, God is directing your thought life, ministering to you, even revealing himself as the King Messiah and the roaring lion? How can you tell that? You can tell it based upon his word.
Yeah.
If you will seek the Lord and get in his word and ask him to teach you, and you'll really put yourself in a position to understand who God is, how he is, what he would say, what he would do, then you'll recognize immediately the counterfeit roar when it comes to your life. But see, so many people have that mixed up, or they're just believing what grandma told them about God or whatever. Amen. Grandma might have been just as sincere as the day is long, but that doesn't mean she was right. You've got to get in the book. You've got to get your nose in the book and get before the Lord and let him start teaching you about him.
Amen.
And he will.
Amen.
See, the Bible says we're to rightly divide the word of truth.
Yes.
Now, if God tells us we're to rightly divide it, that must mean it could be wrongly divided.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
The devil had me convinced most of my Christian life that God was my biggest problem. Along with a few other Christians that tried to teach me that. When I found out, God's my answer. He's not my problem.
Amen.
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 And if you study the word and rightly divide it, you'll see those things. So the enemy comes and he preys upon people who give place to that will give place to the spirit of fear. But if you know who Jesus is, and you know who you are, and you know that, as Mike said this morning, that Bill Johnson, you heard Bill Johnson say it, if Jesus has all the power and all of the right and the might, the devil doesn't have any.
The authority.
Yeah. Jesus said that. He said, all authority, all power has been given to me. And the word actually in the Greek means right and might.
Yes.
So if Jesus has it all, the devil doesn't have any.
Amen.
Aren't you glad you're in Jesus?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God.
Yeah.
So you recognize the enemy's threats, his roar, his intimidation attempts against you, because it comes in the spirit of fear to shut you down, back you off, pull you back in. You lay down right there and shut up and don't do anything.
Right.
Amen. Now, the prophetic voice of God, the roar of God prophetically, emboldens you.
Right.
Have you ever got a word from God and you really needed one?
Yes.
You know, the enemy was lying to you. He was roaring at you. And then the prophetic mantle came forth in some way, either to you directly or through somebody. And there was this roar of God against the enemy's roar. And all of a sudden, you got bold. And you just started telling the devil, shut your mouth, devil, you're a liar.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
Praise God. Now notice he says here in verse 9, speaking of the devil in this roaring lion, this false prophetic thing, whom resist steadfast. we supposed to do? Well, we're supposed to pray that God will kill the lion. Kill the lion, God. Kill the lion. No. He says, you resist him steadfast. How? In the faith. What does he mean in the faith? Trusting what who God is and what he says in his word, what he has said directly to you in a time of fellowship with him or prophetically in some way. You take hold of those words by faith. You take that sword of the Spirit, praise God, and you stand against the enemy. You roar back at it.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm glad I got to preach tonight. I'm having fun. Yeah. Whom resist steadfast? What does that mean? That means I stick my stake in the ground. I'm not moving, devil. You're moving.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Knowing, not wondering, not hoping, not wishing, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. In other words, stuff's going to happen. You know, we're in a fallen world. We're in a world that's fallen. You know, it still has the touch of sin on it. It still has a, you know, it's not the perfect place that God created it to be. That's coming, but it's not here yet. And the devil is going to attack you. He is going to persecute you. Things are going to happen. People aren't going to treat you nice all the time. You're not even going to be all that nice yourself sometimes.
That's true.
But you don't get all out of shape and out of joint and, you know, and go lay down and let the devil eat you for lunch. He says you resist the enemy and his roars. You resist his false prophetic words. And you stand steadfast in the trust and the faith of knowing what the Word of God says about you. And that no matter what the enemy comes at you with, he came at Peter. He tried to kill Peter. He did. Some people stoned Paul to death one day. He raised from the dead and left on his missionary journey the next day. Paul was bit by a serpent that should have killed him within a few minutes. He shook it off because he was doing what God called him to do. He had divine protection on his life. He shook it off and kept going. Had no ill effects.
Yep.
God will be there for you, praise
yes,
God.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
Amen?
Yep.
Hallelujah. So we have to step up and become that roaring lion back at the enemy.
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Now I want to mention here tonight three different people that encountered lions in the Bible. Turn with me over to, let's look at the first one here. Turn over to Judges chapter 14. Judges chapter 14. If you haven't run into a lion, you're going to run into one once, one time or another. And you probably have already run into him.
Yeah.
You just maybe didn't know what he was. You might have went, here, kitty, kitty, kitty. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
This is Judges 14. This is Samson. Samson, a man who had the Spirit of God come on him, and he had supernatural strength. Took the jawbone of a donkey and killed 1,000 men with it.
That's annoying, man.
Amen? Well, it says there, let's just go ahead and read verse 1. It says, Samson went down to Timnath and saw a woman in Timnath of the daughters of the Philistines. Now, Samson wasn't supposed to be hanging with the Philistines.
Yeah, bad girls
down. He was being a bad boy for hanging out with him. And he came up and told his father and mother and said, I have seen a woman in Timnath of the daughters of the Philistines. Now therefore, get her for me to wife. Because back in those days, the marriages were all arranged and all that. Then his father and his mother said unto him, is there never a woman among the daughters of your brethren or among all my people that you go to take a wife of the uncircumcised Philistines? In other words, they don't have a covenant with God. Samson said unto his father, get her for me, for she pleases me well. Anyway, verse 4. But now here's the thing here. Verse 4. But his father and his mother knew not that it was of the Lord, that he, the Lord, sought an occasion against the Philistines. For at that time the Philistines had dominion over Israel. God was picking a fight. There comes a point in time where God's had enough. He's had enough of the devil messing with his kids. And he steps up and he picks a fight. Amen. Now, in the natural, this looked bad. It looked like, oh, this guy's messing up, man. He's going outside the covenant. He's hanging out with, you know, people he shouldn't hang with and all that. And he did have a problem there. Samson was a Nazarite. If you read the Bible and study the Nazarite vow, there were three things you couldn't do. You couldn't touch your hair. You couldn't
drink wine
or touch anything dead. Couldn't cut your hair, couldn't touch anything dead, couldn't drink wine. And all of those, of course, were symbolic. The hair thing was about God being your covering. And, you know, and your hair growing along, it was a symbolic thing of God being your covering, your protection, or whatever. And then the wine was about judgment. You know, a drunken person doesn't have good judgment. And a person who'd taken the vow of a Nazarite was going to be used of God in a certain way, and they need to have their faculties all in order. Yeah. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. And then the dead body thing, that was just a thing of the old covenant that, you know, under the old covenant, if you were sanctified or set apart for a purpose, like a priest who went through the sanctification process and was ready to minister in the temple, and he touched something dead, that dead person made him polluted, and he had to go back and be re-sanctified. Amen? And so it was a thing where you didn't touch dead bodies. I like the New Testament. I like it when Jesus brought in the New Testament thinking, when dead bodies touched him or he touched them, they woke up.
Yes, amen.
They didn't make him unholy. He made them alive.
Amen.
Amen. Still working that way today, too.
Yeah. Praise God.
Thank you, Lord.
So God was working through this to pick a fight. Verse 5, then went Samson down, and his father and mother and his mother to Timnath, and came to the vineyards of Timnath, and behold, look, that vineyard is hanging out in the wine.
Yes. So, yep.
And behold, a young lion roared against him, trying to intimidate him. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him, and he tore, or he rent him as he would have rent a kid. Talking about a little sheep or goat. In other words, grab it by the mouth and just rip it apart. And he had nothing in his hand. In other words, he did this barehanded. But he told not his father and his mother what he had done. Now here is an example. The Bible says that we're to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. We have the strength of God in our lives. As we yield to his strength, as we become weak, he becomes strong in us. As we humble ourselves under his mighty hand, he lifts us up.
Amen.
Samson was an example of this. He had the strength of God on him. And this lion, this came to roar against him. And he responded in the strength of God. And in that strength of God and that anointing, he destroyed what that lion was trying to do. He stopped that lion and destroyed it. You and I are well equipped to confront every roaring lion that comes against us.
Yes.
God will give you the strength. He'll enable you to destroy your enemies and run those demons off or whatever has to happen.
Yes.
If you allow the strength of God to be upon you.
Praise
you know, Paul over in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he said, you know, everywhere he went, he would have a revival and a riot.
Right.
And he got tired of the riot. I would too.
Yeah.
And so finally he prayed three times and he said, Lord, get this off my back, you know, get this thing off my back. And it basically, he was talking about a fallen angel there. People have taken that area of scripture and tried to turn it into some kind of sickness he had. But if you study the words, it's obvious that it means a demonic spirit that was assigned to him to try to stop him. And so everywhere he would go, the people that were listening to the devil, this fallen angel would inspire them to come against Paul, but God would also use Paul to do what he was doing and planting the churches. Well, Paul prayed three times, get this off my back, basically is what he said. And God's response to him was, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace, what I did through my son on the cross and the way it is legally now in heaven, that's more than enough for you to have victory in every situation.
Hallelujah.
But Paul, you got to remember this, God told him over in 2 Corinthians 12. He says, in your weakness is where you will get my strength.
Yeah. That's good.
Amen. Amen?
Yes.
See, it's when we come to the Lord and we acknowledge that it's all him. And we say, Lord, you have the answers to this. When I'm weak, that's when I'm strong because I've put my trust in you. And that's what Paul went on to say over there in 2 Corinthians 12. He said, I will therefore gladly magnify my inability to perform.
Yeah.
Because when I submit myself to God, knowing that I can't do it, That's when he says the power of Christ comes upon me, like it came upon Samson here, and he was able to defeat the roaring lion. He was able to defeat those false prophetic things that were coming against him to try to stop him and shut him down.
Yeah, amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In the strength of God, we're well able to deal with the roaring lion. Yes. That intimidating spirit of fear that tries to roar in your thought life and tries to, you know, make you submit or make you back away or make you pull away from what God is saying for you to do.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Yes.
Resist him steadfast in the faith. Praise God. Now let's turn over to Daniel chapter 6. Let's look at another one. Glory to God. God's good, isn't he?
Yeah,
this is, of course, Daniel the prophet. And Daniel was a man who was committed to God. He was going to, obey God no matter what. From the time he became a POW in the nation of Babylon, he stayed submitted to God. He was a man of integrity. God used him, promoted him in spite of all the enemies and all that kind of thing. And his enemies were trying to get at him. They were trying to get him out of the way. So they knew that this king, when a king in that nation made a proclamation, he couldn't go back on it. So they talked this king into using this, they used this king's pride and talked him into making this declaration that when this musical sound was heard across the land, everyone had to bow down. Everyone had to submit to.
Right.
Then that was the three Hebrew children, and then they got thrown in the fire. And then after that, there was a commitment where God, where they had this thing where you couldn't pray to any other god except, to the king's god or whatever it was. And so Daniel was caught praying, of course, because he prayed three times a day. He would open his windows and pray toward Jerusalem. So he got in trouble, and the decree was that he would be thrown into a lion's den. Verse 16 in chapter 6. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God, whom thou servest continually, he will deliver you. The king didn't want him to die, but the king couldn't back up on his commandment or his decree. But here he is prophesying that Daniel's going to be okay. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet, and with the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. In other words, he's going to have to spend the night in here with these hungry lions. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. Pretty good when you got the king fasting and praying for you.
Yeah.
Neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste to the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God whom thou servest continually able to deliver thee from the lions? And then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. My God hath sent his angel. Everybody say angel.
Angel.
And hath shut the lion's mouth that they have not hurt me, for as much as before him innocency was found in me. And also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. Then was the king exceedingly glad for him.
Yes.
God will protect you with his angels.
Yep.
And notice, Daniel, the reason he said, I was innocent in this. I was a man of integrity. You know, you're the king of the land, and I'll submit to you as that, but you're not my God. I can't submit to you as my God. Amen? The devil always tries to work things around where he makes you compromise God in your life.
Right.
If you witness on the job, we're going to fire you from this place. Well, that's okay. I weighed this much when I got here anyway.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
People are going, and you don't just go around witness all day. They're paying you to work, not witness. So you need to work.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Amen.
Right.
Yeah. But at the same time, Daniel, this book of Daniel, is a wonderful example of people who stand their ground, hold to their integrity, and keep God in the right place in their life. And because of that, God's hand was upon him, his protection was upon him, and when these lions should have had him for dinner, there was angelic protection sent to guard him, and the same thing will happen with us.
Yes.
The devil may threaten, he may intimidate, He may come to you in the middle of the night in some kind of weird vision or dream or nightmare. He may send a head witch in Madera to your house. It doesn't even matter. Because he can roar all he wants to. He's messing with the wrong person.
Amen?
And we can stand our ground. Because of God protecting us. Hallelujah. The lion can roar. They were probably down there roaring all night because they were hungry. They're over there, man, there's lunch right over there. They were roaring. I got a weenie dog at home that groans when he just intimidates us until we feed him. He comes, he sits down and he stares at us and goes, And then when that doesn't work, if Karen's laying down somewhere in the bed or whatever watching TV, he'll go and get up on the bed and get right in her face and start barking.
Oh.
You do, huh? Kids do that. They start barking. We won't go there, I guess. But anyway, so here's another case where the roaring lion.
Yep.
You know, man, they're roaring, but that big old angel right there's got a sword in his hand, and I know if I try to go for it, I'm going to end up lion sandwich or something.
Yeah.
Now let's look at the last one here, 1 Samuel. Anybody ever heard of somebody named David?
Oh, yeah.
1 Samuel chapter 17. Now, we're in a time, let me just, as you turn over to 17, let me just say this. Back in 2010, the Lord came to me as I was fellowshipping with him, and he told me this. He said, you know me as your father, you know me as your healer, you know me as your savior, but you don't know me very well as king. In the role of king. You don't know how to, and because I didn't know him, what he meant was, I didn't know how to relate to him in that role in my life. And so he began to teach me about that. And he told me this at that time. He said, in the days just ahead, I'm going to shift into that king mode in the earth and move mostly in that in the earth. Well, that's the line of the tribe of Judah. That's the king, you know, the king Messiah, and so forth. And it makes sense because if you study the word, you find that when we're shifting into a new season, even in the natural realm, you know, when you're in fall, you get a little summer and a little winter through that whole three-month period, right? We've got a lot of summer, now we're getting a little winter, but we're still in fall. Well, when you're kind of spiritually, when you're coming out of a season where God has been doing certain things a certain way to mainly what he's been doing is reinstating things to the body of Christ that we've lost in our lifetime and even before our lifetime. Now, though, he's shifting into that mode where he's going to come back. If you read the back of the book, he's going to come back as that lion. He's going to come back as the king Messiah.
Yeah.
He's going to come back, and he is going to roar, and he is going to rule and reign and dominate over his enemies.
Yes.
That's the season that we're approaching. We're in the last of the last days. I'm not saying he's going to come when you and I are alive. I don't know. But I do know that we're in the last of the last days. That can be proven through history. So God's in a king mode.
Yeah.
He's in a lion mode.
Amen.
He's going to roar against the enemy. So if I'm going to go with God and flow with him, I'm going to have to understand, as he told me in 2010, how that all works and how the angels and the Lord of hosts and all this thing works. Because God is taking back what belongs to him. He's coming to us before he comes for us.
Yes. Yes.
He's going to reap a harvest. He's going to drive the Philistines out of his harvest field. He's going to drive the money changers out of his temple. He's going to drive things that are in us. It's not always something that we're rebelling in or sin or whatever, but he's going to come and drive the things out of us that are ripping off the glory. Because we're coming into being the glorious church.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. So he's not this, you know, meek, mild shepherd petting on a sheep right now. Now, he is that to me and you, and will always be one of his sheep. And the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want, and all of that. But there's times when, and there's another side to the shepherd, too. You study the shepherd. The shepherd's staff wasn't just so he wouldn't fall down on a rock.
Right.
It was so he could kill enemies of the flock.
Yeah.
And this story right here is about a shepherd. Who was a type and shadow of Jesus and his king ministry and the shepherd ministry as well. But what I'm saying is that we're in a time right now where God is invading. He's doing a warfare of invasion in this earth, and he wants you and I to understand that so that we can go with him in that. See, he's looking to David's whole life was just a type and shadow of Jesus in his kingly ministry. David understood how to be a prophet, he understood how to be a priest, and he understood how to be a king, he understood how to be a shepherd, he understood how to be a psalmist. Amen? He was a mighty man of valor. All of those things is who Jesus is. Amen? And so, you know, we're in a time where the Lord is wanting us to catch hold of that, and he's going to be using us. He's already doing things. He's already invading. He's already turning things and changing things. And it's going to become even more intense. You know, David, when he was anointed king, he killed Goliath. King Saul got jealous, started throwing javelins at him. Here we are playing the harp, and all of a sudden, whoop. You think you work for a rough boss?
Yeah.
I was about to work for that guy.
Yeah.
So he finally, you know the story, had to flee and hide in En-Gedi and out of the wilderness and all this. And there were people in Jerusalem and in Israel at that time that were broke, busted, and disgusted. King Saul wasn't working for them either. Amen?
Yeah.
They weren't a part of the corrupt system that was going on. And they apparently understood enough to know, you know what? David really is the one who's supposed to be king. I'm going where he's at. I want to join up with him. And the Bible talks about these people not being what you would call successful people in the society, but yet they were people that went out and joined themselves to that lion anointing, joined themselves to that king anointing, and they became David's mighty men of valor.
Amen.
And when you read about them and study about them in the scripture, man, they were some bad dudes.
Yeah, they were.
Amen.
Yeah.
That, you know, David was a gifted in warfare. He had an anointing on him to make war. Listen, you don't throw a rock in a sling, and hit somebody out in front of you. It's one thing to plunk them in the head, put a big knot on their head, or maybe even crack their skull. But the Bible says that rock sunk into Goliath's head. You talk about a 100-mile-an-hour fastball.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
And so there was this ability, this anointing to make war, just like with Samson. There was this thing that happened. Amen?
Amen.
And so this is the scenario, I'm sure you know already, 1 Samuel 17, where he's about to go up against Goliath. But look with me at verse 34. This is where he's explaining to King Saul that he's willing to step up and do this thing with Goliath. David said unto Saul, your servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear, and took a lamb out of the flock. See, what's the devil doing? He's trying to steal from the flock. He's trying to get God's people. And I went after it. Can you just, just stop and think about that for a minute.
Yeah.
Here comes a lion. I'd almost rather fight Goliath than fight a lion. I don't know about you.
Yeah.
Here comes a lion, grabs a little lamb, starts running off with it. What does David do? Well, I guess we'll write that one off on our taxes.
Yeah.
No. He took his job as shepherd so serious, and he knew that he had an anointing to protect the flock. And he went after that dude.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
He went after him. Praise God.
Yeah.
I went out after him and smote him. That's a King James way of saying I knocked him in the head. What did he knock him in the head with? Well, probably either his sling or his shepherd's staff.
Yeah.
And delivered it out of his mouth. And when he rose against me, I caught him by his beard and smote him and killed him. God will give you the ability to fight and win over the roaring lion.
Amen. Yes.
See, this is some close quarters stuff here.
Yeah.
This is some close quarters. This is not, you know, way down there or something. He got in tight, close with this lion, and he grabbed him by the beard. I don't know if it was his mane or a beard. You know, some of those lions, I think, have kind of a more of a beard type. He grabbed him right up under his mouth and smote him and killed him. We have an anointing upon us to destroy, not put out forever. You can't kill a demon. They're a spirit. They live forever. They'll live in the in torment in the lake of fire forever. Right. But we have the right to fight spiritually and have that victory.
Yes.
We can smite that false prophetic anointing.
Amen.
We can smite it with the anointing that's upon our life. We can win the victory.
Yes.
We can protect people.
Amen.
When the devil starts attacking your kids, go grab that lion and knock him in the head. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When he starts roaring against your household, you need to roar back. You need to let the word of the Lord rise up in you.
Yes.
Let me tell you what I'm going to do. That's what David did here.
Yes.
He understood he was king. He understood he had that thing on his life. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Glory to God. Look at verse 36. And the servant, thy servant, he says to Saul, slew both the lion and the bear. And this man who has no covenant with God, like I do, this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God.
Right.
You're in the army, my friend.
Yeah.
As Mike was preaching about that this morning, I was sitting over there, I kept hearing, I heard this probably at least 10 times. It came up in my thought life 10 times. Said, welcome to Gideon's army. Welcome to Gideon's army. How many of you know Gideon's army is bad?
Yeah.
Thousands of people showed up, but God says, no, there's a whole bunch of them that aren't soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He said, first thing you do is stand and say, if you're afraid at all, go home. And that took care of the vast majority of them right there.
Mm-hmm.
And then it put them through these tests, you know, of how they drank water and all that to eliminate other people. And I've heard people preach on that as to what it was and what it wasn't. I have no idea why God did it that way, but
yeah.
He did it. And ended up with 300 people to go against thousands. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
See, this is what God is raising up right now. He's raising up some people who are willing to be God's army. Willing to be, even if we're just a small. See, you and Jesus are always a majority.
Yes.
You, with the will of God in your heart and your mind, the plan of God in your life, and the authority of God on you, you've always got the devil outnumbered. Outpowered, out authority, like Mike was preaching this morning. David said, verse 37, the Lord hath delivered me out of the paw of the lion, out of the paw of the bear. He will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said unto David, go get him, dude. Go, and the Lord be with you.
Yes.
And you know the rest of the story.
Yes.
That happened in that. But here are three people, Samson, Daniel, and David, who were confronted by that lion, by that false prophetic, by that spirit of fear, that intimidation. In this case, Goliath, the name Goliath means soothsayer. A soothsayer is a false prophetic anointing. It's attached to the demonic realm. And so here's Goliath comes out there every day between those two armies and, you know, prophesies to the army of Israel. Send somebody down. If he can beat me, then we'll be your servants. If I beat him, you're our servants.
Right.
And the people, because they didn't have the same understanding that David had, they're hiding out in the rocks, intimidated. And then when somebody showed up that had a little courage and had a little boldness, had a little understanding, they're trying to tell him he's wrong. You know, there's a difference between being bold and being arrogant.
Yeah, exactly.
People, it says of Jesus' ministry in the Gospels, it says that one of the things that astonished people about him was he taught them with boldness, not as the Pharisees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's right.
God hates this mealy-mouthed Christianity. Well, I just don't know you. What the Lord is going to do, and I hope so, and I just...
Right.
God wants you to be bold.
Yeah.
He wants you to step up. He wants you to stand up.
Yeah.
He wants you to look the devil in the eye and tell him, you're going down, not me.
Yes.
You're moving out of my neighborhood, not me.
Amen.
You're leaving Madera, not me.
Amen.
You're letting loose of the United States, not me.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
But if you haven't been, and you probably already have, haven't been confronted by this spirit that comes with the spirit of fear to intimidate you, to, you know, try to put you in the place the enemy wants to keep you so that he can continue to devour you, your family, and have his way in your life, it's that spirit's going to show up sooner or later. And we need to respond to it just like Peter said.
Yes.
He said, be serious about it. Be vigilant about it. And he said, because he's going to come like a roaring lion. But it says, if you'll resist him in the faith, that's what David did. David didn't get up and go, look at me, man, I'm the guy. He qualified, he prophesied to the giant. You don't have a covenant.
Yep.
It's because of my covenant with God. Do you have a covenant with God?
Yes.
Is the blood of Jesus right now speaking of everything God won for you at the cross, speaking about your life, and giving you total victory over the devil? It says over in the book of Ephesians, give no place to the devil.
Yes.
Amen.
And if you look at it in the original, it means don't open the door and let him in.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We are the victorious church.
Hallelujah.
Because Jesus has won that victory for us.
Amen. That's why.
Yes.
Praise God. I, for the life of me, cannot understand why people fellowship with the spirit of fear.
Right.
I hear a lot of Christians talking about, you know, different movies they watch. And I said, what do you watch that for? Oh, I get an adrenaline rush.
Yeah.
Really? I think I could get an adrenaline rush in another way.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what gives me an adrenaline rush, the presence of God.
Yeah.
The glory of God.
Yeah.
Amen?
Hallelujah.
But the spirit of fear can either be a roar or it can be a very subtle, even still small voice. The devil duplicates it all.
Right.
God had to. Back in 2000, I went through a crisis in my life where the enemy tried to steal my mind, basically.
Yeah.
And I went through this thing of, you know, post-traumatic syndrome, they call it, and depression and anxiety and all this. And you get into that, you start swimming in that cesspool, you'll get serious about getting out.
Oh, yeah.
And as I cried out to the Lord, he began to show me the spirit of fear in my life. He began to take apart, because what the devil wants to do is he wants to come in so subtly and makes fear a part of you to where you don't recognize it as fear anymore. You just think it's you. And that was what had happened to me.
Exactly.
And he started spelling it out for me and showing me. I remember one time coming down that hallway there when I was going through this. I had, it was a fearful thought or a feeling or whatever. And my immediate, you know, knee-jerk reaction in my mind because of the way my mind had been renewed was, I thought, well, that's just me. And I heard the Holy Ghost, I mean, he got on me like a chicken on a June bug. He said, no, that is not you. That's not the way I created you. That's you under the influence of the spirit of fear.
Yes. Right.
And then he started teaching me how to recognize it and how to deal with it.
Amen.
And when I started just simply obeying, you know, him resisting steadfast in the faith, I started obeying what he told me to do, it started working.
Yeah.
I'm not saying everything just flip-flopped overnight, but I'm telling you that it was amazing to me. How that, and I hadn't recognized all those years how the enemy was roaring in my ears all the time with the spirit of fear, and I didn't even realize it. I mean, I did when it would get really bad, you know, if it was some bad thing happening. You know, you're going to go broke, or somebody's going to die, or, you know, that kind of thing. But there was that subtle thing that he would do to keep me in my place. Jesus showed me how to deal with it.
Amen.
Praise God. Because he dealt with it already for me. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. You know, just for fun, as we close, let's just read the scripture over in Revelation chapter 4. Revelation chapter 4. I'm sorry, it's not Revelation 4. It's Revelation 5. I wrote down the wrong scripture. I'm surprised you Bible scholars didn't catch that. That was supposed to be a joke. let's just start verse 1. It says, "And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne," that's the Father, "a book written within and on the backside sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the book and loose the seals thereof?' And no man in heaven nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book." Nobody in heaven, nobody in earth, and nobody in hell. "To open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders saith unto me, 'Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of who?
David.
King David hath prevailed."
Yes.
Everybody said prevailed.
Prevailed.
"Hath prevailed to open the book and loose the seven seals thereof." In other words, this was the process of starting the end of days, winding this thing up that was revealed to John here in the book of Revelation. How many of you know the book of Revelation is not about the Antichrist?
Right.
It's the revelation of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
The Antichrist is mentioned a few times,
right,
but he's really just a speed bump in the road.
Right.
That's really about all he is right
Amen.
There.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
I remember this one preacher, he had a dream or a vision, and he'd been in the Navy. And you know, God uses things that you know about, just like Jesus would teach about agriculture and use it as spiritual, you know, to teach spiritual things. Well, this guy's been in the Navy, and he saw these two ships, and he said they were coming right at each other. And it was like he was on the one ship on the bridge, and he's yelling at the captain and the people, you know, to turn this way and to do this and to do that, and they weren't doing it. And he said, "These two ships are coming right at each other." And he said, "I braced for impact." And he said, "When they came together," he said, "nothing happened." And so it was a dream. I think it was a dream. And he said he woke up the next morning and he said, "Lord, what was that?" Because he said, "I knew it was a God dream." Was, you know, when you have a God dream, it's different than a regular dream. He said, "I said, God, what was that? What was that impact about?" He said, "That was the tribulation."
Huh. Wow, that's good.
People have used, and we've been guilty in the church of just scaring the daylights out of people about the 7-year tribulation period. I remember Karen was telling me when she was a kid, if she knew they were going to preach on end times at church on Sunday night, she'd fake a sickness and stay home.
I didn't fake it. I got sick.
You would get sick, huh? Wow. I thought you were faking it. Praise God. But you know what? We have nothing to fear, folks. We have nothing to fear. I don't care what Russia's doing.
Amen.
I don't care what radical Islamists are doing.
Yeah.
They're sowing for their own destruction.
Yeah.
You start killing people, honey, you're going to end up dead. Mm-hmm. Osama bin Laden found out about that.
Uh-huh.
So did the guy over in Iraq. What's his name?
Hussein.
Yeah, whatever his name is. Saddam
Hussein.
Bible says if you live by the sword, you're going to die by the sword. Amen? Praise God. The only sword you can wield and not get killed over is the sword of the Spirit, which is the reins of God. Praise God. So we've got victory. We've got victory over roaring lions. I think we are going to see some things here in the near future in the earth. You know, the Lord's going to do some roaring. And when he roars, things are going to shake. And demonic structures are going to come down. When demonic structures come down, the people that have been in place because of those demonic wicked spirits in heavenly places, they're going to come down. They're going to get all disturbed and upset. And you know, things are going to happen. Some of it, the enemy's going to roar, and God's going to roar too. But guess who's going to end up winning? God. So don't be afraid.
No. Amen.
Tell the spirit of fear to take a hike.
Yes.
Tell the spirit, in Isaiah 54, it explains to you what the spirit of fear is and how it operates.
Right.
And it's not in you. Paul said it. God has not given us, in the new birth, he didn't give us, when he gave us his life and nature, he didn't give us a spirit of fear.
Right.
The power of love and a sound mind. Over in 1 Corinthians, it says that love flushes out, mature love, an understanding of his love and who he is and how much he loves you. Flushes out fear is what it says in the original word.
Thank you, Lord.
Washes it away.
Thank you, Lord.
He's given us the spirit of faith.
Yeah. Amen.
Power, love, and a sound mind. The mind of Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
And so we can stand up in that. We can face the future.
Yes.
And we can listen to the roar of the lion in our spirit, and we can roar with him and prophesy and release into the earth. Amen?
Yeah.
We can obey God.
Thank
praise
you,
God.
Lord.
Well, Father, thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For your word tonight. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to be intimidated by the enemy. He's a defeated foe. You defeated him 2,000 years ago.
Yes.
You brought him to naught. You brought him to nothing. Your word says, we have a recorded of your voice and what you said, that now, you said, 2,000 years ago, the prince of this world is judged and cast out. He has no more position of authority that Adam has given him. All he has is that lying voice. Try to get us to believe what he's saying. And so, Father, we thank you. God, I pray that you'll teach all of us how to let the lion rise up in us. I pray for every one of us under the sound of my voice, those that are watching online or those that are in this room, God, teach us how to yield to the lion of the tribe of Judah that lives in us. Teach us, Father, how to flow with that, not to war against flesh and blood, not to be in some kind of arrogance, but, Father, to be bold when we need to be bold.
Yeah.
The word says the righteous are as bold as a lion.
Amen.
But the wicked flee even when nobody's chasing them. Lord, we thank you for it.
Yes,
we
God.
Praise you for
I
it.
Love you,
I thank you that boldness comes upon your people. I thank you that they'll not be intimidated any longer.
Yes.
But that they'll stand up and they'll allow you to roar through them. And when the enemy roars against them, they'll do what David did. They'll do what Daniel did.
Yes.
They'll do, Heavenly Father, what Samson did.
Yes, Lord.
The anointing being upon us
yes.
to do what we need to do in those situations.
Yes,
we thank you for it, Father.
Father.
We praise you for it in Jesus' name. Let's just thank you for it tonight. Amen.
Thank
you, Lord.
Thank
you, thank you, thank you,
thank
you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you,
your word is true,
you.
Lord.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Trust.
Hallelujah. You see, the church, we've got to put the devil in his place. There is no scripture that says in the New Testament we're praying, ask God to do something about the devil. He already did it at the cross. He took care of business. It's that way. It's settled. There's four or five New Testament scriptures that tell us if we'll resist the devil, he'll flee from us.
Amen.
Amen. He's not afraid of John Pursell, but he's afraid of who's in John Pursell.
Yeah.
And he knows that when I exercise that authority that's in me, in Christ Jesus, he better flee.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he's going to get all of heaven's forces after him. He doesn't want that. Amen? We've got to rise up and be bold about things.
Yes.
You've got to tell sickness what to do.
Right?
You've got to tell the enemy and all of his lies. You shut your mouth in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
You know, when I hear about somebody in the church or in my family that's being, maybe somebody is being used of the devil to make their life miserable and they don't deserve it, I speak to that spirit that's operating that person. I command you in the name of Jesus, you shut your mouth and you leave that person alone.
Yes.
Amen.
You have the right to do that.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.